So we have a lot of exciting geographic expansion. My goal would be to cover all 50 states by the end of 2022.
Sam, CEO of Oshi Health, thank you so much for being here. A warm welcome to the Scope Forward show.
Yeah, thanks, Praveen. Excited to see you again and to have a chance to talk about Oshi Health.
Yeah, so before we get started, Sam, I want to read out your profile for people to know what your journey has been like. So in building Oshi Health, Sam combines his passion for redesigning healthcare around the needs of patients with a mission to increase access to the high-quality whole-person care that two of his family members have needed to manage their digestive conditions. He's held leadership roles across healthcare technology and tech-enabled service companies focused on improving population health. Sam lives in New York City with his family and enjoys spending time deepening his knowledge of how our bodies and brains work and cheering on the Philadelphia sports team and the NYCFC. So I'm happy that you put that in. So what's been the journey like so far for you personally? And I can see there is a personal story here and for Oshi Health as a company.
Yeah, so I've been, like I said, working in healthcare my whole career, always with how do we use technology to improve care for people? I was working in diabetes, and we were scaling access so that people living with type 2 diabetes could get access to diabetes educators, sort of a rare resource, a lot of them with dietitian training or social worker training, to figure out how to better manage their diabetes. And you know, we saw a lot that food was an important part of managing diabetes and sort of, you know, what you ate. And there was a mental component to it as well. And you know, learning about adhering to your medications, right? All these tools that we helped people learn and really make changes to their diet. Then we saw a lot of innovation happening in diabetes around us, so, you know, interesting companies like Virta Health, which basically said, hey, we've got evidence that this ketogenic diet can work for metabolic disease. What if we actually gave people better support to implement it? And I saw that innovation, and then I sort of paired it with my mom's journey getting diagnosed with IBS. And basically being told by her gastroenterologist about the low FODMAP diet. And the way that interaction went was, here's a one-page handout about low FODMAP. You should go check this out. You should see if you can find a dietitian that understands this, that can help you. You know, good luck. Come back and see me in 6 months and, you know, let's see how it goes. And I think he also prescribed her a medication at that point. And, you know, my mom has interesting tools. She grew up with a dietitian mother. She's an engineer, so she thinks analytically. She's actually a cook. So she was able to go learn about low FODMAP and figure it out. But the interesting part is that didn't solve the problem. You know, she still landed in the ER twice. And when I was trying to unpack with her what happened, you know, I started to learn about the gut-brain connection. You know, we realized she had a lot going on in life, was under a ton of pressure, had some anxiety, and that could have played a role in the escalation of her symptoms. And so she went back to see her GI after figuring out her dietary triggers. And literally his mind was blown. And he said, you know, you're the first person I've ever told about this that figured it out. What did you do? And I heard that story and I was just thinking about, you know, my experience in diabetes and these other care models. And that was the light bulb for me. You know, maybe a Virta-like model would work in GI. And, you know, my sister also lives with Crohn's. And so I've heard her journey and she's really struggled to get support that would take time to understand her. You know, she had some unique aspects about her life that really never got factored into her care. And there was very little focus in her care around what could she actually do day to day in her life and what support did she need to actually get there. And so all of these things came together for me to see this opportunity for higher touch care in GI using technology. And so that's really, you know, what we've been building at Oshi.
By the time you joined Oshi, there was always, there was a history with Oshi, correct?
Yeah. So the company had been started based on some research showing that when you gave people symptom tracking tools, people with IBD between their visits, and you sort of checked in and you had this, you know, check-in call, you know, akin to what SonarMD and others are doing, right? There's a lot of research that shows that that works, but people didn't always have access to the tracking part. So there was a thesis that if we give people this tool, they can use it to better understand what's going on for themselves. You know, what are the what are the things that might be contributing to their symptoms with IBD? If we give them a lot of content, they can learn about, you know, all the different aspects that could be at play, and they'll be able to better self-manage and take this data to their physician. What we saw when we launched that, tons of interest from the patient community. I think there were 60,000 downloads of the app. Where it broke down was it was too hard for people on their own to figure out which of these things going on in their life or influencing them were triggering their symptoms. Even if they could track it all, they couldn't always connect the dots. We came to the conclusion technology alone isn't going to solve the problems here. And pair that with the story I just told you about my mom and sister and sort of seeing this opportunity and parallels in diabetes care and other sectors. We saw the opportunity to really transform the company from a self-management platform to a care delivery company.
So how long has it been since the company was founded?
So the company was founded a couple of years ago. I entered the mix at the end of 2019 with this completely, new idea, new business model. We really started proving out the thesis in 2020. We started this all pre-pandemic with the question at that point being, will people use telehealth and will people pay for telehealth? And then obviously with COVID and the pandemic, we saw that it sort of forced everybody to try out telehealth. For the most part, people liked it on both sides, the clinician and the patient side. And that was fuel for us. It also opened up a lot more payment for telehealth and a lot more sort of acceptance of that as needing to be part of the care mix going forward. So that was obviously tailwinds for us. We started seeing patients in December of 2020, and we launched our first payer-sponsored program in March of 2021. So we've been now seeing patients through that program, several hundred people, and we're getting great early results.
Congratulations on raising the $23
million
marquee venture capital companies and also quite notable healthcare entrepreneurs and several other people. So from that point to now, it's been a few short months. And so what actually triggered investor interest in the company, or was it already there by that time?
So I think investors were intrigued, because they hadn't seen much like this in GI. We have a couple companies in the space that have been innovating in GI, and that's great. But nobody was really saying, hey, we can deliver care. We can help people get a diagnosis. We can prescribe medication. We can also fill in the gaps, the dietary and the psychosocial support that a lot of people with GI conditions need. And as they started talking to the payers and the employers, they realized, hey, this is an emerging area. People are seeing the costs in GI, in total go up over, year over year. There isn't really a strong indicator that outcomes are getting better. And so I think people are starting to say, hey, should we be doing something differently? Do we need to start to evolve care delivery in GI? And so I think part of the reason we got the investment is we have a strong vision and we've started to prove it out. So I mentioned we've seen a few hundred patients at this point, amazing satisfaction from the patient side, 98% satisfied, NPS scores that are five times the industry average. But we've also seen people saying, in self-reported data, my symptoms are better. I actually feel more in control of my symptoms. We are estimating that, we've been able to actually really make a difference in cost by preventing escalations and getting people better managed, better controlled. And so a lot of this comes back to the parts that are hard for GI clinics to do, the dietary support, this really frequent touch. We're talking to people on average every 2 weeks. So this is a very high touch, high frequency care model that complements what the current system can do.
Mm-hmm. Describe the model for us.
We provide people with access to a gastroenterologist, nurse practitioners, dietitians, psychologists, health coaches, and a care coordinator. That's their team that OSHA is giving them access to. And we're doing this in a very proactive, high-touch model, using all of the evidence, really sort of taking the first visit to unpack, meet the person, understand what's going on, capture past records so that we understand what's already been done, what's already been tried. And then come up with our care plan for that person. We also make sure we understand, hey, are you already seeing a gastroenterologist? If so, we don't want to get in the way of that relationship. We want to be able to complement it. We want to be able, if that person in that clinic doesn't have a good GI dietitian or psychologist, we can be those parts. We can be the between visit support, and we can make sure your GI is informed about anything that we might be doing with you and vice versa.
So do the patients pay for this, or their insurance or employer? Who pays for this?
With a higher touch model, you know, if people are having to pay co-insurance, co-pays at every single touch point, when we're asking them to meet with us every 2 weeks, that's going to be a barrier to people getting this more preventive, proactive care. So we're working with the plans and with the employers to pay us in a way where the patient responsibility, it's not zero in most cases, but it's akin to what they would get, you know, in a traditional care experience.
These hundreds of patients, you know, that you already saw, did they pay you directly, or did they use their insurance card? Like, how did that work?
Yeah, so for the first few months before we launched with the payer program, we did have a cash pay program. And that was really, honestly, just for us to test and learn. So we charged very low prices because it wasn't about profitability or money. It was about, hey, we want to see what this care model looks like in real life. We need to iterate and improve our own processes, our own systems of delivering care in this way, how we train providers, you know, how we're monitoring quality, all of these, you know, key parts. So our first, you know, batch of, you know, a couple dozen patients were cash pay. And then we launched the payer program in March and really shifted our focus there. So the people we've been seeing today have not been paying because it's part of this program. And that payer chose to cover the entire cost for the member in this program. We're actually running it as a study. So we have an IRB approved protocol. We're actually measuring the results. We're measuring satisfaction, symptom improvement, symptom control. We're measuring quality of life and workplace productivity impact. And we're also measuring, we will be measuring with a matched control population, the cost and utilization looks like with OSHI patients versus people who didn't come to OSHI.
I want to read out a quote that I saw in the press release, and it just caught my attention because it was from one of the investors. The quote is, one of the largest cost drivers in healthcare is spend associated with GI disorders. It manifests through specialty drug spend, repeated ER visits, unnecessary scopes, and lower workplace productivity and impairment. And then it goes on, OSHI Health offers an integrative model to support GI patients across every step of their journey, whereas before, it was such a disparate and dissatisfying experience. I found the quote, you know, very, very telling. In fact, it seems to me that it brings together everything that OSHI and your team of investors, you know, is doing. There seems to be a lot of frustration with the existing healthcare system, and it is broken. And you already talked a little bit about it, but I'm interested to know what that core frustration is like, you know, for you as a team.
I don't blame anyone in the current system, right? Everybody is sort of a function of the system they're in. We built a healthcare system that at its core didn't start with, let's build it around the patient and what the patient needs. We've really built it around the payment model and the provider's efficiency. And so everybody's sort of playing in that game today. And that's the fee-for-service system. Like I said, we started with what will solve the patient's problem? How do we make it a great experience to get that kind of support? And then we'll figure out the payment model. And we're pitching that, right, to the payers and the employers, like, hey, we've really rethought how we can help people with these conditions, you know, within the system, and then add in the parts that don't really exist in the current system. So I think the quote reflects that. And when we're talking to employers, employers are increasingly seeing GI hit that top three spend category. And those are the things that they start to put energy and money and effort toward in terms of innovation. They like to test out stuff like OSHI and roll it out to their people. And, you know, they'll hold us accountable to actually show them that it is a better experience. You know, it can lower total cost, you know, all of these things. There's this very slow movement toward value-based care. And I know you've talked about this a bunch. You've talked with many of the GI leaders pushing in that direction. We want to be a tool and a resource to help the industry as we make that transition to value. And we want to make sure that it also is a great experience for the patient and that we actually get the outcomes that we need. I worked in diabetes. It was super simple, relatively. You prick your finger at home, you get a number. The number tells you how you're doing. You can go get a blood draw and get an A1C, and it's, you know, a quality measure. Comparatively, that's very simple, right? You know this in GI, we don't have those simple measures. And that makes it harder for people to understand, like, what is quality? You know, are people getting better? And really have to ask the patient. And you need to check in on them more frequently than our system is designed to do. And I think the investment is reflecting that we need to reinvent care, and we've got an idea of how to do that. We're going to need help and support from the GI community, and we look forward to partnering. We've had some payers say, we should really get OSHI and a couple of our large groups together and look at value-based care and see if we can set up a test of OSHI's model plus the large GI groups. And so these are the things we want to do. And you're seeing this happen in MSK and other spaces. We want to help GI as it transitions to value over time.
It's right. Like you build things around the patient and don't worry about money because money comes later, which is what happened. For OSHI, and it is a happy story. But for the private practice world that is stuck in the managed care system, almost one of the first questions, like, for example, if you go and say, why not try out virtual reality for IBS, or why not try out AI in the endoscopy room? Almost one of the first questions, whether it comes up directly or not, would be, who's going to pay?
Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, I think at the end of the day, we have to show that those things generate outcomes and that they can reduce cost. I think the benefit we have is all the research that we're based on has been out there for many years. It's just, to your point, it hasn't necessarily been appropriately funded, right? People haven't pushed hard enough, in my opinion, to redesign the payment structure for GI. And in part, that's what we're trying to do. We're anchoring it really around these dietary and psychosocial interventions that we can deliver, and sort of, more tightly monitoring medications between visits with the gastroenterologist, the parts that have a ton of evidence, right? The medical home model for IBD. These are the things that we're anchored on. I think these new innovations and capabilities like VR, the AI, as they're studied and as there's clear evidence, they should be paid for appropriately. So hopefully we'll see that happen. I think all of these tools are needed to continue innovating in GI, get better outcomes, make sure that physicians and practices are compensated for their services appropriately, right? All of these parts.
Now that you've raised the money, how are things going to change for OSHI over the next 1, 2, 3 years?
So right now we're operating in a handful of states. We have some new relationships that we'll be launching in January, part of the new benefits here, that'll take us into a few additional states. Really, our goal is to continue expanding geographically. We are providing care, so we have to comply with all the, state licensure, corporate practice of medicine, all of those laws. And we have a lot of effort that goes into that, but we'll be expanding to new states as we have payer and employer partners funding our care for people in those states. So we have a lot of exciting geographic expansion. My goal would be to cover all 50 states by the end of 2022. We're really pushing hard to make that happen. We need to keep building the payer and employer relationships. To do this kind of scaling, we need to invest in our clinical team. So hiring, training clinicians of each of the types I mentioned to deliver great GI care in our model. We need to continue building partnerships in these markets with the local GIs and their groups. We are not doing any procedures. We aren't doing the physical examination when that is really something that's important and needed. We need great partners to do those things. But at the same time, many GI clinics don't have access to dietary and psychological specialists, and we do. And we're building and scaling a workforce of those providers so we can be a great partner. We can do the between visit monitoring to make sure your patient is staying on track. And if they're not, make sure we're quickly intervening so they don't end up in the emergency room. And if they need to get in touch with someone, they can quickly get in touch with us. It's all very technology forward, and we can make sure they get the right care. And that might be back to their local GI doctor and make sure we coordinate that. And then the third thing is investing in our technology platform. Our tech platform has two sides to it. There's the tools and the content that we give to the patient to really better understand their condition and to track and make progress against a care plan that we've set for them. And then on the clinician side, making sure our clinicians have tools to efficiently provide care to more and more people.
Mm-hmm. Now, you have some gastroenterologists on board. Is the plan to hire more GI doctors on your team?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, as we scale, especially to new geographies, we will need additional gastroenterologists to work with us, to oversee the care, to do visits for the patients that, have more complex conditions and really need their, high level of expertise on those cases.
Are you becoming the teledoc for GI?
Yeah, I guess in some ways we are, in the sense that, you know, Teladoc isn't necessarily, like, there's still plenty of volume for the emergency room, unfortunately, and the urgent care centers. But now there's a quick access option that should reduce total cost, right? Giving people faster access to get GI specialized care in their time of need, to maybe get the parts that are harder for brick and mortar clinics to fund today, you know, back to the funding thing that I've heard many GI clinics say, you know, it's hard for us to justify the spend on hiring a dietitian or a psychologist. Well, our whole model is built around that. We may find patients coming to us for the dietary and the psychosocial where they have an alarm feature present and really do need to get in and get a colonoscopy or endoscopy. And we need partners to then help that patient. So we're really looking over time to build our own network of partners in each geography to work together and solve the needs. And eventually, I think, get into some value-based payment arrangements with health plans.
What's in it for the practices to partner with the digital health companies?
So, and this is always the first thing that comes up when we talk, right? It's the what's in it for me. And I understand that it's a business. People are, you know, it's their livelihood. When you really unpack it and you sort of get past the sort of fear that you're going to steal my patient, right? We got to talk about it. That's the fear that comes up naturally right away. And that's not what we're trying to do. But when I ask questions, we get at, well, what do you do when you have a patient with IBS and you've tried medication and it's not working and you know that person needs dietary and psychological, but you don't staff those roles? What do you do with that person? And what do you think that experience is like for that patient? You know, they're frustrated. And, you know, some practices will say they're clogging up the practice because they keep calling back wanting help. I don't know what else to do for them. So when we get into that kind of conversation, it's, okay, what if you referred those people to us? And we were actually able to get the person feeling better sustainably with these interventions. They're going to have a much better impression of you as the gastroenterologist who got them the help they needed.
A practice might think, anyway, we got to go the telehealth route. So why partner? Why not build all this ourselves? If Oshi could figure it out, you know, we should figure it out. What would you say to that?
I've had that conversation too. I think that it's not trivial to really redesign the experience from the patient's perspective. So sure, could you slap some telehealth tools on? Could you sort of replace a visit that you would do in person with a phone call or a telehealth visit? Yes, but that's not changing the entire experience for the patient. It's not adding the components of care that you don't offer today. If you aren't getting contracts from the payer to support all of these things, are people really going to make that investment, to your point at the beginning? Like, we're out pushing the frontier here in terms of the payment model. You know, maybe down the road, others will be able to benefit from that. But it's not just slapping telehealth on the current workflow, in my opinion, that's going to solve the needs here. We really have to rethink the model.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever considered buying a GI practice and throwing yourself into the ring? There's private equity money that's consolidating GI, and you can get a whole volume of patients to take care of, and maybe physicians that are part of the practice.
Yeah. I think hopefully this helps people understand it. We're not trying to compete. We're trying to complement. The answer is no. I want to scale to be a nationwide support for the patient and let the practices really optimize their business and have people feel like they're getting a great outcome working with a local GI. Like, we want to partner for that. I don't want to compete with you for the things that a brick and mortar gastroenterology clinic and ambulatory surgery center do.
Yeah, thanks, Sam, for, you know, playing along with all these different questions. But getting back, what is the ultimate vision for Oshi here?
Yeah, I think to show that we can deliver great experience and great outcomes for the patient, and we can also make the economics attractive for everybody involved. You know, lower total cost for whoever's paying, whether it's an employer, but also still have a good business, you know, for ourselves and for partner clinics. So, and we want to do that at national scale. We want to actually demonstrate that the outcomes are getting better for the patient. You know, that's something that's largely missing in a lot of our healthcare. And we want to make the experience much better for the patient, you know, really have them feel supported.
Considering all the technology trends, all the business trends, you know, the direction of where everything is going in healthcare, and if you throw a stone that far out, where would it land?
5 years in healthcare is not far to throw a stone. But, and I think this is the question, is when will things have true value in the payment model, right? I think 5 years ago, we were probably saying, oh, in 5 years, that'll be the case. And it's not. So I won't be as bold as to say we will shift it entirely to value-based care where people are actually compensated for great outcomes at a reasonable cost. I don't know that we'll get there, but we'll move forward in that direction. I think you've got a lot of new colorectal cancer screening modalities coming out. And obviously you talk a lot about this sort of warning against the procedure volume being the anchor of the business. You know, I think that that stuff is going to become a bigger part of the mix. I think that we'll see new technologies like the VR stuff you mentioned, right? If a patient can learn the cognitive behavioral therapy through VR, and we have to use less human capital and fewer visits to help the patient get that outcome, that's an amazing innovation. You know, what will that work for every single person? I don't know. I think some of them will still need the live human, you know, support and interaction. Maybe it'll just be complementing those technologies and sort of personalizing those technologies. I think we'll have a lot of improvements in the personalization of the medications that we use. I think that we'll start to figure out which patients respond best to which types of therapy. Yeah. So, I mean, and I think we'll be an interesting data set and all of that, right? We're data driven from the core. We're capturing a tremendous amount of data. We're measuring our own outcomes. So over time, we're going to start to see what works for different profiles of people. And we'll have a huge GI data set, maybe the biggest in the country in 5 years. That's part of our vision, where we could actually be a decentralized clinical trial site for anybody wanting to do research in GI. So, you know, these are some of the things I think we'll see and sort of how we also want to be a part of that innovation. That is our core focus.
Yeah. And one thing that I wanted to also ask is, what are the risks in your model? What are the unknowns here?
Everything that we're doing has been studied in a brick and mortar care delivery. And there's gold standard research showing the impact that each of the different tools we're putting together can generate. Nobody's ever actually put it all together in a virtual first delivery format. And so I think what a lot of people say is, well, will it work in the way that you're delivering it? And can you do it at scale? I think, you know, another thing, there's not enough GI specialized dietitians and psychologists today. And I know there's others in the industry pointing this out, and there's good training programs that have developed. You know, we want to be part of that. We want to help build that workforce because they're really important to the outcomes. And to the support that people want and need. So we have a risk that we have to find as many of them as we can and train them and give them a great place to work to specialize in GI dietary and psychological interventions. I think it is a risk, again, if we're perceived as a threat. That's not what we're trying to do. I'll say it over and over and over, and hopefully people will eventually believe me and they'll want to talk to me about it and we can have a good dialogue. But you know, we want to partner with GI clinics. There's no more clear way to say it.
The whole, objective of these interviews and everything, you know, the writing has been to actually touch on the mindset of the industry itself. And if the mindset can shift, then magic can happen across the board. Everybody benefits. So thank you so much for, all these perspectives, your views. It was fantastic to learn.
You know, thanks for you for putting out a lot of great content. I enjoy listening to all the interviews with leaders in the industry. Helps me learn. I'm constantly trying to learn the perspectives of the different players in the ecosystem. So thank you for doing that and for the chance to talk about OSHI. And I hope that we can engage many folks in the industry in a dialogue in the coming year.
Fantastic. Sam, congratulations once again on the fundraise to you and your team. I know it involves a lot of hard work. So I wish you really, really all the best. And I look forward to a transformed GI care space. So thank you.
Thanks, Praveen.